Ladies and gentlemen, children of all ages, welcome back to the Marty Zostra Too Much Information podcast. Thank you for joining me again. Episode 5. Episodes 1, 2, 3, and 4 went well. What did you think? Make sure you leave me some notes in the comments. I want to hear from you. I've been getting good feedback from all kinds of people all over the world, including all the way from London, England, down to the United States of America, and back again. And I'm really excited for that. Today we are going to talk about the continuation of my music journey. Last week we had my friend Sam Stevenson on the podcast. He played in Sweetheart. He is a fantastic guitar player, a very creative man, and I was really happy to have him. He was integral in my musical career as a friend and confidant. So let's dig in. Part one, I want to talk about something I touched on my last podcast. Anybody who writes songs or is thinking about writing songs or is thinking about starting a band, if you bought a guitar, you bought a keyboard, you bought some drums, and you're thinking about improving on your instrument, what I did late in my music career is I bought some recording gear, and that's what I did. I bought it in and got a MacBook, as everybody did back then, and started a little home studio. And that improved my songwriting because I was able to hear things and remember things and play things and add to things and throw it at a wall and see if it would stick. And so that improved my songwriting greatly because I was able to hear things back and remember things, even if they weren't finished, even if they weren't good, just so I was able to tell if it was something I'd keep or throw. Right? Something I left out of the story, though, is earlier on, I actually had rented some gear and recorded some demos. And that small, about week-long experience of just doing stuff with a kind of a crappy digital 4-track and a Shure 58, call it, plugging my guitar directly into the board, that entire process inspired me to later on get my own gear, get my own Mac, and get my own little mini recording studio, mobile studio, so that I could write new ideas and become more prolific. So that's what I did in 2008, and I just started ripping through some songs. And when you're in a band like Sweetheart, it's four people, it's a democracy. You're writing songs together, note for note, eyeball to eyeball, in jam room. Well, when you're a solo artist, you don't really wait for other people. You just spew the information out. And I was able to start doing that into a computer and onto a hard drive. And I'm going to play you a demo from that time. It was probably one of the first or second songs I wrote in that period. A really rough demo. And the song titled Kiss Me, Piss Me Off was a pretty that's a weird name, right? Dark song, but upbeat, kind of one take for the actual arrangement, if you can believe it. I just sort of tracked it over a drum loop with the intention of putting it on a record eventually. Here we go, let's play it. The intention of me playing that song, and as you can hear, it's kind of quirky. I'm heavily influenced by artists like Beck, Radiohead, still a big influence on me today. The reason I played that song was because it was just a different direction from Sweetheart. And I think I maybe pitched that song to the guys and they said that wasn't really them. Now, so what ended up happening is I did this over and over and I repeated it and repeated it. I realized I had another genre, another group of songs, another style that did not fit the band. So I ended up just keeping all these demos on a hard drive and slowly built it up. And to this day, I still have about 100 or more rough ideas, all the way from full finished songs to one chord or with whistling or humming or one lyric idea or something. At the time, I built these demos up, and I had an intention of releasing a record at some point. I wanted to do that, and I was thinking of going like solo and with Sweetheart. I was fairly loyal to the band. I didn't have a lot more time, and I'll tell you why. Something else that happened in that time frame, 2008, 2009, 2010, is I wanted to make some extra cash on the side. To be honest, it's expensive, as we all know, to live in Vancouver area. So I wanted to make a bit of extra cash and convince some buddies to start a cover band. Yes, I did. I started playing covers too. And you can make some cash playing cover music. Let's be honest. That's one way that all the way back to the Beatles in Hamburg playing cover tunes to today, many people do it and they are very successful at it. In fact, at one point in their career, that's how you learn new songs. And sometimes you perform it live and sometimes you record it and sometimes it goes up the charts. It's one of the oldest tricks in the book, Twist and Shout by the Beatles. I got some gigs with this band. You started to make some money, you know, $100 here, $100 there, $50 there, $150 here. And the intention was to maybe throw that into a solo record and slowly build up a catalog of non-Sweetheart and solo and sort of a new direction for people who are interested in something other than pop, power, punk, indie, dance, heavy, rock. With a weird edge. And that was what was happening. I was writing and recording and I was putting demos down and I was saving up some cash playing cover bands and getting really busy. And as time went on, got into 2010, made more money playing in a cover band than I was in Sweetheart, and also certainly stopped thinking about my own solo career because at some point you got to make some money playing music. So what ended up happening is some of the art got delayed. And that's totally fine because I look back at that time and I look back at those songs and there's some good sketches, some decent ideas there. But in all honesty, nothing that excites me even today. Except for that first song I just played you. So 2010, 2011, I decided to started up again, keep going. I'd moved in with a good buddy, my old pal Phil Bell, who was the bass player of the February March way back in that story about that tour in 2007. And he was still a good friend of mine playing sometimes in the cover band I was in and various projects I was in. So I moved in with him and I had this little room and I was recording demos and I decided I was going to do some blogging. I was going to do some songwriting, release these demos one by one sort of weekly for a while. And so it gave me a timeline. It gave me a deadline. And that's what I ended up doing. I started one by one releasing these songs. And so I'm going to play another song here. Now, this song was written in that time frame. It's called Last Angel Left in the City that I call home. I'm going to play it for you, but this is a little different because what ended up happening is that recently I went back to this song because I really always liked it and re-recorded some parts, and I got my friend Nate from one of my favorite dark wave bands, Ultraviolence, to sing some parts on it. And this is unreleased. This was written in 2010, late 2010, and released on Bandcamp, the website, digitally just as is for people to listen to in about January or February of 2011. So here we go. This is called Last Angel Left in the City that I call home. Take a listen.
Disappoint you if things get too fast. I'll be the one who holds you if you cry. If you cry, darkness to be disposed of gets pushed down so fast. It feels like natural disasters in your mind. In your mind, if not so. Right here by my heart.
Thanks, Nate. That sounded great. I love your voice with mine. I think I have a sneaking suspicion that you and I are going to, down the road, do some more recording. Nate's voice is dark. It's beautiful. His music is dark and beautiful. Tortured. Nate and I talk all the time. Thankfully, we've become sort of friends from afar, although we've never met, and I love it. And thank you, Nate, for singing on my song. Hopefully, that song will get released and I'll get it mixed properly. So, 2011, that was kind of 2011. Just releasing these demos, but there was some it was a bit interrupted because in the September of 2011, Sweetheart released our record finally after all this time. So Sweetheart was running at the same time. I was playing cover in a cover band at the same time. I was recording and writing at the same time solo. I was moving around. I lived in a couple different places. I was trying to get my proverbial shit together here. And I did. I got it together. The day our CD was released, Sweetheart CD was released, is the day I met my now wife, Lindsay. And that's a long story, but it was kind of the beginning of life getting a lot better and more stable. Finally, thankfully, because for 3 or 4 years, I'd been living on couches, living with friends, begging, borrowing, pleading, living with my brother even for a period. And it was a time of upheaval and a time of no stability at times. But you know what? I still had good times and I still have lots of good friends from that period of my life. And I look back, I'm not going to say that it was bad or dark or negative all the time, because it wasn't. That would be a lie. But what I will say is that I was very happy that my life started to finally stabilize in September of 2011, the day I met my now wife. Little did I know then. And that was our CD release party. So in 2011, Lindsay and I were talking and she said, I have this opportunity. She just started working for a hotel and she was getting some training in Memphis, Tennessee. And so she said, do you want to go to Memphis? And I said, are you kidding me? I mean, yeah, I would love to go. And we were having a lot of fun then. And she said, well, why don't you fly down? So I flew down. She flew first, and then I flew down and met her. We were on Beale Street at a hotel. And we're, by the way, if you've never been and you love rock and roll, you got to go to Memphis, Tennessee, of course. We went to Graceland. We went to Sun Records. I stood in Sun Records where Johnny Cash and Elvis Presley recorded some of their early big hits. That was a time, man. And that was an experience. I never thought I would be so moved musically when I was there, but I could feel the presence of greatness, obviously, because I was in the presence of the past greatness of Elvis Presley and rock and roll, birthplace of rock and roll, Memphis, Tennessee. And we were up on Beale Street. We went to this bar called BB King's, and there was a band there, just a house band, and they were just ripping through all these R&B funk soul classics, and they're just the house band, yet they're the best band I've ever seen still. I was like, what am I doing with my life, man? What am I doing with my life musically? Sweetheart was kind of, what happened around that time is Wheezy had left the band, and we had some fill-in bass players who were great bass players and friends. Jason Wheeler, a friend of ours who jumped in on some gigs playing bass. And then we had Jared Bolin, who was a great friend who jumped in on bass for a few gigs. And we had some talks of tours, and we had some talks of getting things going and doing more. And I think we all kind of listened to the demos and we listened to the ideas coming out of the group, and maybe we weren't as passionate to keep pushing at the time for some reason. And so it didn't feel like it was moving forward quickly, and it didn't feel like it was moving forward at the right pace. And then I went to Memphis and I saw these bands and I was moved, and I could no longer feel confident in a cover band where I wasn't excited about it, and I could no longer feel excited about a band that I wasn't excited about myself. I'll be honest, that's what I wanted. I wanted to play with people that were better than me so I could elevate myself, and also make money doing it. That was key, because Sweetheart had moments of greatness, you know. We went on tours, we took home a bit of cash, we sold records, but nothing was consistent and nothing was carried through, and we weren't great at the business side, to be honest. We're a punk band most of the time, a DIY punk band, selling CDs off the back of the stage or the back of the van to pay for gas to get home. That's what we were doing, to be honest. That's exactly what we were doing. But I wanted a bit more. I wanted some cash. I was tired of being a weekend warrior cover band guy. I wanted to be in a cover band, either a cover band I was proud of, or a band I was proud of, or making music I was proud of, with people that were better than me. And that's very key. When I came home, I said, well, I love the Beatles. They're my favorite band. I'm passionate about the Beatles. John Lennon is my guru. I've read all the books. I know everything about the guy. It's weird. Yeah, it's crazy. Disciple of John Lennon. And I love his path because it's so tortured and his voice is so moving. I phoned a couple friends. I said, do you want to start a Beatles band? Go out and start playing gigs as a four-piece tribute to the early Beatles, playing all their rock and roll hits from this early era, call it. And so got this group together. And I was really lucky to meet two other guys, literally off of Craigslist. So it was my friend Nick Jones, who was in the February March, and then Mike Coots, my now friend, and then Michael Hurley, my now friend, who started a Beatles tribute band. And we started playing, we started gigging, and I remember the first rehearsal when we'd hit the first three-part harmony in I Feel Fine, first song we jammed, and it sounded amazing. And so the point of this is, when you play music that you're passionate about and it sounds really good and then you start making money at it, man, does that change your life. This isn't like a diatribe about being in a cover band or not being in a cover band, or it's just my journey, man. And so playing covers and playing originals and playing in bands and playing in punk bands and playing large stages and small stages, that's just the whole journey altogether. It's one piece of art. My entire musical career is in a sort of a melting pot or mosaic of my life. And so I played gigs in tiny little pubs with an acoustic guitar, and I have played with a wig on and a Sgt. Pepper jacket and a keyboard and a guitar and four people beside me playing Sgt. Pepper front to back on a large stage in front of 500 people. I've done that. I've played punk rock with punk rock bands like Chicks Dig It in Calgary in front of 500 people. I've recorded DIY records in basements. I've recorded full records with a full studio with professional musicians backing me up. And that's every single one of those things are amazing because they're all, I did them all. And I look back at all of those fondly because it's part of my journey. As that band progressed from that spark of an idea in Memphis, Tennessee on Beale Street at BB King's, from that day to today, that band is taught me how to be a professional musician, to be blunt. Everything up until the point where we started that band got me there. And I'm really lucky that I had a partner in Mike who, in a lot of ways, we feed off of each other and have learned as we went as a partnership. And I appreciate every moment of Mike keeping me honest and teaching me. And hopefully I've taught him something. I don't know if I have, to be honest, but he's certainly taught me a lot. And I thank him for that. He's taught me a lot about the Beatles, and hopefully I've taught him a lot about maybe being more something. I don't know. Disorganized. The Beatles band started and we started playing, and I was still writing and recording songs and as a solo artist. And so this part of the story, here's what I'm going to do. Right now I'm going to play you my band, the Day Trippers. I wasn't going to, but I've got a demo and it sounds great, so I'm going to play it for you. It's recorded at Monarch Studios by Elisa, and it's cool, man, and I'm going to play it for you. Here we go. I want to hold your hand. So that is a cover of the Beatles' famous number one hit, I Want to Hold Your Hand, with, it was an early recording of the Day Trippers. You know, you can hear it's kind of got a bit of an original feel, maybe less tribute in it than at the time we wanted, but it was fun to make, and we got to do that on a day at Monarch Studios, Tom Dobransky's studio of the Zolas, a wonderful, wonderful studio, and we had a blast doing that. So, at around the same time, I was writing songs because in 2013, I had this grandiose idea. I wanted to do it all. I wanted to record with Sweetheart. I wanted to record solo music. I wanted to play and record the Day Trippers. I wanted to play gigs solo. I wanted to play gigs in the Beatles band. I wanted to play Sweetheart shows. I wanted to do it all. I wanted to stay busy. I loved it. I was busy that year, really, really busy. And in September of that year, like I said earlier, I wanted to work with musicians that were better than me so I could grow. Not that the people I'd play with before weren't as good as me or weren't helping me grow, but I wanted musicians that were I thought of as my, quote, heroes, proverbial heroes, players that I never thought I could sort of hire because I thought of myself as just a punk rock kid. And so I phoned up my friend Carl Davis, who mixed the Sweetheart EP. And Carl is a lovely man, and I've chanced to spend a lot of time with him because he recorded my record, a record of mine. He taught me about something about music that, you know, people forget, which is music is about a feeling, and music is about a feel, and music is about being organic, and the magic captured in studio, and Carl's really good at that, and his passion gets me excited whenever I hang out with him. And Carl, if you're listening, I love you very deeply. What I'm going to do is play a song that I recorded with David Spidell, Carl Davis, and Carl's brother Eric on drums. David Spidell being maybe who I consider the best bass player in Vancouver, possibly. I consider him to be the best. There are many, many amazing bass players, laundry list of killer bass players who can play jazz, funk, soul, rock, pop, prog, you name it. But the thing is that Dave can do all of those things, and I've done some of those things with Dave. Been lucky to share a stage with the guy, and I've been lucky to have him play on my record. And here's a song right now. So this song called Brighton, I started playing. We were on our way to the wedding. We got married in Mexico. It was a destination wedding, so this is 2013. May, I was working on this song. May, June. And so, four chords and the truth, my friends. But I started playing it, and from C to A minor, like, talk about simple chords, but I started singing it, and I started, and it just came through me. And so, this is the first song I recorded with Carl. It's called Brighton, and I hope you like it. And it's with Daryl Havers on keyboards. Daryl Havers being Brick House, a Vancouver, a legendary Vancouver band. I don't know if there's anybody better on keyboards in this style in the city of Vancouver, but Daryl absolutely killed it on this session. I love what he did, and here's the song. Thank you. That was Brighton. So now we're playing a lot of music on this podcast, more than the last four. So episode 5, part 1 of my solo career story. The reason it's part 1, and I'm going to nearly close it up here. The reason it's part 1 is because I released these three songs that Carl and I, well, Carl produced and I sat and listened to and helped him make some decisions, some timely decisions. We recorded those songs. I released them one at a time in May of 2014, roughly 2014, 15, sort of May, June, July-ish, or October, somewhere in there. Three songs, and the three songs were great. Brighton was one, obviously one of them. Put them out into the world. It was fun. I was doing some cool stuff. I felt like I had a bit of momentum. I played a show, played a couple of shows, was also gigging with the other groups that I was in. You know, doing everything from being in a cover band to playing Beatles music, playing as a solo artist, which I wanted to do. And I thought I had some momentum, and I thought I liked the songs, and I thought I liked the direction, which was almost like an alt country, alt pop with a lot of Britpop influences. Obviously, that's what I thought represented me, and I was going to develop that. And I had even started recording some new stuff and started releasing other things later that year. And my personal life was going really well. Lindsay and I were expecting. In March of 2015 is when my musical career stopped. This is where the podcast is going to end. So what I'll do is I'll leave it here. I got one more song to play for you. At the end of the first stage of my musical career, I found out my mom was sick and I threw everything away. I quit. I said I quit. And what I'll do now is I'll play you the kind of the last thing I released in that time. And it kind of ties all the way back to Sam, who was in our last episode. Sam and I had written this song for Sweetheart. Thanks for listening. That was episode number 5 of Marty Zylstra, Too Much Information. What did you think? You got comments? You got questions? You got, what do you got? We're going to do a mailbag. I told you we were going to do the mailbag, and we're going to do the mailbag. I have a couple of guests lined up for the next few episodes. I'm hoping to talk to David Spidell, who played on a few of those songs that you just heard. I also have a friend, Ryan, who's going to come on as well. Ryan, get your phone ready. But we'll be talking to them coming up soon. I also can't wait to tell you the story of Beyond, how I relaunched. Call it relaunched. That's a better term. I relaunched my solo career. And, you know, it's going to be a tough episode to listen to. So, fair warning, if you don't want to listen to episode 6, I'm totally fine with that. Anyway, see you next week. I can't wait. Sundays at 9 a.m. here on the Marty Zylstra Too Much Information and Podcast. Thanks for listening, folks. See ya.